Okay, good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming. And this has been quite an intensive experience over the last 4 days, beginning with the opening session on Thursday, going through the 4 days of studio, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and today, and having the midpoint check-in on Saturday night. It's been a lot of enthusiasm. A lot of you have participated in this, and we just want to jump right into it. So I'm going to turn this over to Brian Wright from Town Planning and Urban Design Collaborative to give you the update on where they are right now in this process.
All right. Hey, my mic's on. Good. All right. So for those at home on TV, watching the TV, I'm going to do my best tonight not to tap on my mic so much. Apparently everybody could hear it when I was like, is this thing on? So, all right. So this is the fun part of the of a charrette, the rushing in at the last minute or beyond the last minute. Luckily, you guys came in droves tonight, so it bought me a little time, but we've been scrambling around trying to get everything ready for you guys so we could have a great discussion tonight. So for those who it's their first time to participate, my name is Brian Wright, and I'm the principal of Town Planning and Urban Design Collaborative. And I've got a great team here with me who's been helping me all week. We've been working to help you guys sort out a few issues and figure out what to do to make sure that the most loved part of the city is protected in the future with the zoning. So I've got Kara in the back, and Emily and Pam, and they're all three back there. And if you guys have seen Kara and Pam, they've had their little babies here all week. So I didn't make them come, I promise. They just couldn't bear to not be a part of this. So I've got JJ in the back. He's done all the beautiful renderings I'm about to show you. I've got our apprentice Jesse there at the door. Many of you talked to him. Well, so I have Bill Wright, my dad is there. He's the coding expert, dealing with all the nitty-gritty stuff, all the words that need to be written. Did I forget anybody? I always do. Usually I forget my dad. But okay, so what we want to do is go through a presentation pretty quickly, and so we can, as always, get to the most important part, which is the end, the question and answer session. I'm going to try to cover everything that people have been asking about and giving us input on, and anything that's not in here, it doesn't mean that we left it out on purpose. It means that this was a crazy 4 or 5 days, and it's, you know, it's yet to be part of the presentation. So one thing we've been doing is taking a survey on how to spell the word rhythm. We think we have it right now, but we Googled it, and then everybody, it still looks weird. So anyway, if it's still wrong, I apologize, but. So, some frequently asked questions. And remember, I told you there's not spell check really this good on this software that makes it all zoom around. And this, I don't usually have this many words in my slides, but I felt like there are lots of questions asked frequently. So I'm going to go through this. This will be the most boring part of the presentation, but everything else will be interesting, I promise. So, what's the purpose of the project? So, we want to prepare for continued infill development on underutilized property. So, that's one of the big things. So, we want to recalibrate the dimensional controls for scale. Hot topic in this town, that is for sure. We want to streamline the process by creating standards in the zoning. So the HDC primarily is focusing on the details. So they're not getting the whole thing and having to like, whoa, what's going on? I have to review everything. So what are the steps in developing the form-based code? So the inventory analysis, the visioning that we did the other night, we want to then move into the writing and the creating of the graphics, because remember, one of the distinguishing characteristics of a form-based code is it's very, very graphical, unlike other typical zoning ordinances. So it'll be nice to look at when we're done. So why do a form-based code or zoning ordinance? Why not stick with the zoning we have? I'll say this. If you want to continue coming out every time to the HDC meeting and fighting about things, then you can just stick with what you have. If you want to move past that and be able to enjoy all the nights of your week, we can clean it all up and do the form-based zoning. So that's the short and tongue-in-cheek answer. So and then the last one, what are the next steps? So this process is really just the very, very beginning of what's going to happen. The next thing we'll do is go away after you guys give more input tonight, and we'll start to work on what will be the first draft. And we'll give that then to staff. They'll give us comments from their perspective. We'll incorporate those comments, and then we'll give it back to them, and then they'll distribute it to everybody, to all the proper boards and authorities that have to take a look at things, and you guys as well. that'll be available for input. And then, as with any zoning change or any zoning improvements, it'll go through the normal approval process. You get all your opportunities to give your official input. Right now, this is the informal input session, but it's a great time because we can really start at the very beginning instead of waiting until we get farther down the road and then say, what do you think? So those are some of the most frequently asked questions. Now, some people have asked, what is form-based zoning? I don't understand that. Some of it will become even more clear as we go through the presentation here. It's embedded in it. But in a nutshell, for those who are new tonight, the form-based zoning approach doesn't focus so much on use as a distinguishing feature. It's able to be much more sophisticated and more fine-grained and look at the character of each of the different areas. And we've gone out, as you'll see in a minute, and really, really done our homework. We've seen every nook and cranny of this place and really are incorporating that into the zoning in a way that a conventional use-based ordinance never can. So that's kind of the nutshell. So as we go through, I'll feature that. Oh, one of the other frequently asked questions is, who the heck are you guys? And what the heck do you know about places as awesome as this? Well, historic, I mean, that's the kind of the key thing here, the key distinguishing feature. But so we work all over the country. We work for cities who grew up in the 50s and 60s and have no heart, no historic core. They've got nothing but strip highways and just kind of nasty stuff, and they want to be like you. And so they hire us to help them be like you. And to do that, we have to study you and other places like you. So even in the unrelated work that we do, it's related to you. We also work for historic places. And some of these historic places have very, very similar things going on that you guys do, but they haven't quite caught on to it like you have. So this is an example in Georgia, outside of Atlanta, in a place called Monroe, a historic place. This is what they call an alley. And we found, looking at the historic maps, like we looked at your historic maps, that there were some things that had happened over time that had changed the character of this place. So we came up with a concept for them to help them transform it into, does this look familiar to you guys? This is like your commercial alley, right? You guys, I could have shown them your example to help explain it, but this is what we came up with for them. Here is their historic downtown, their core. This is the county courthouse. Amazing, looks like Back to the Future if you've seen that movie, you know? The clock tower and Marty. And you notice here, like you guys do, what was once historic fabric has now eroded, and other things have come in the form of often parking lots. They actually have a suburban gas station here as well. And so we showed them what they could do to transform and repair that. Now, we were looking at their entire city when we did their process for them, and they had some other areas that weren't historic, but we focused on the historic areas as well, and they've got the historic marker to prove that they're historic. So we've also worked in Burlington, Vermont, very historic place. Many of you have probably been there. It's amazing. These are some of the plans we came up with them for their waterfront and for their historic downtown core. Here's the master plan, and again, they've been infiltrated by parking lots as well. And so a lot of when you do infill, it's showing you what to do with that underutilized space like we talked about. And the thing that's really cool about this, yesterday, we recognized how historic this place is, and a couple of things that were important happened here in Burlington, and more than in Monroe. This is the plan we did for them, the master plan. We're working on the form-based zoning right now. We did it in the form of a magazine, so it was very accessible to the public. It was very, kind of cutting edge. We thought it was cool, but we just found out yesterday that it won Plan of the Year in the state of Vermont. And it turns out that, and I'm not just bragging, I'm just saying we know what we're talking about here. So, but it turns out that Plan of the Year in Vermont is voted on by the New Hampshire Association of Planners. So your people voted for Vermont's plan. Pretty awesome. So this is pretty neat. I'm glad to see, this is what I like to see happen. There's more people at the end than at the beginning. So that means kind of word's getting out. But here's how it's broken down so far, approximate number of participants, because some of you didn't want to sign in or forgot to sign in or whatever. So opening presentation, about 100 people. The check-in, about 50. Studio drop-ins, just people coming in while we had the open studio and we were working in there, about 100 different people coming in. And then here, we add to the numbers at the end. But it helps to, you guys have 23,000 people. This is just a drop in the bucket. But the thing that we found that's really, really interesting is that the people who show up, yes, oftentimes it's people who are concerned about a specific thing, especially when we come right in the middle of some hot topics going on. However, we also find that just the average representation of the citizenry happens to be here too, in a this person and that person. And so we really do get a good sample, even though we have, you know, a tiny fraction of your population having participated. So one of the things that we've been doing is studying this place. And, you know, we've been trying to figure out what is it about some of the things that are going on here that are freaking everybody out. And so we figured out that some of it has to do with proportion. You guys talk about massing of the buildings, and you're focused on that one building right there, and also kind of how it fits in with the buildings next to it. But it seems most often to say, well, it's taller than the other buildings. Well, a lot of times what's going on is that these sort of proportional ratios that are set up for kind of human comfort that we know about get thrown off in many cases. And so if you have a narrow street with really tall buildings, it makes people feel somewhat uncomfortable. That's why the much taller buildings in Market Square work much better, because you have much more room there and people feel more comfortable. So kind of these are the sort of generally studied ratios that people go through for spatial definition with building height. And so we went through and we applied these to your city to try to start to understand how some of these things work. And, you know, as you go down Congress, it's very interesting. You get different moments of these proportions as it widens and widens into Market Square. From a planning perspective, very interesting. And here we went through the side streets, and you can start to see this is kind of a 2-to-1 ratio, and then here's a 1.5, and you know, it gets bigger, and then here this starts getting different. And then you, even looking at this, this is kind of a 3-to-1 here. And you know, people, even though this is tall, something about it, the intimacy of it makes you feel comfortable in there in a lot of cases. So there's some interesting things going on, and of course we had to take the picture on trash day, but sorry about that. We'll replace that. But and then we also heard about people being concerned about the view corridors and view sheds, and so there was, you guys were in a mode of parking lot preservation for a while, because parking lots showed off the steeple and things like that. And so we started saying, well, what if we, you know, kind of looked at it in a more detailed way and started to break this down kind of analytically, and we have the water views and where you have those few moments in upper, and I'm talking about, you know, there are these moments where, you know, I'm walking around town and bumping into people as I'm studying, and I say, oh, look, right there between those two buildings, I can see the water. You know, there's this 5-foot sliver, you know. And so you're like, you need a sign, you know, water this way so you can peek through there. And then you walk on a little further and you see there's a bigger one. And you can. So as we were trying to figure out all the different opportunities for that and looking at long views to steeples, and not only to the steeple, but other important buildings. And, you know, kind of looking at the concept of a terminated vista, I think I mentioned earlier in the week, where you have important building kind of lining up the view. So this is kind of how, you know, we were starting to analyze it and start to understand these things. And it began to, you know, kind of from a big picture level, start to help us understand some things we might be able to include as we're looking at zoning. So it's important to understand. We started studying building height. And as we were looking at, you know, the idea of proportions, you know, we're looking at human proportions, you know, how many Jeffreys make up this building here. And I think this is about 31 feet. So that's how many people equals about 31 feet, if anybody's wondering. You guys always want talking about feet. But the thing that's interesting is, you know, this is, I think, underneath the height that people seem most comfortable with in the city. But, you know, some of the things that, you know, I wouldn't say that this is all that interesting of a streetscape to walk by, no matter how tall the building is, you know. I mean, I have to say, for a newer building that is a bank, and, you know, they've addressed the street, they pulled it up to the street, they've, you know, done some of the right things. But, you know, as you start to understand, it's not just low heights that make people feel good about being in a place. So I showed some ideas the other night, some big picture stuff, threw it out there. It helps us kind of get an idea of, you know, the ideas are fine to talk about, but, you know, this effort really is about zoning. And so some of the things we were looking at didn't have much to do with zoning, but within it and within your commentary, within your feedback, we're able to start to understand some things. So here, the most important thing, the takeaway from all of this is, if you do nothing but repair the damage that's been done, this place will be even more amazing than it already is. And the thing that I, you know, as I looked at this, I see all these gray areas. that are all these parking lots that are open. And I was like, oh, I can't believe how many parking lots you have. And so I imagine there would be, you know, a lot of opportunities for infill, a lot of chances to, you know, where you need to do something. It would take a lot of buildings to kind of fill in the gaps. But what we found is these dark buildings are the only few buildings that are able to, you only need a few buildings to fill in those gaps. It's amazing. So as we start to study all of these different components in the zoning, we looked at different concepts for these character zones. And we walked around, I personally, not just my team members, I have walked every single one of your streets. And I've photographed it, and we've documented, and we've measured. I know exactly what's going on out here. And so we looked at these different zones, starting with the most intense and most urban, and we want to graphically illustrate, you know, what that might look like. So this would be character district number 5. And so what you see is, you know, commercial on the ground floor, office and, you know, other mixed uses, residential above, varying heights. And, you know, this is the thing that's great about it is you're like, oh, well, I know, that looks like something I recognize, you know. Again, a lot of places we work, this we have to show them something that they don't currently have. So the neat thing about this is it's really about taking your DNA of what you have and making sure that that's in your zoning. So we went through and studied that. Then we moved on to the 4th character district. This starts to get, you know, kind of much more interesting, much more mixed in its different building types. You see, you know, detached buildings and more pitched roofs and, you know, all sorts of things. A little bit of setback for some greenery sometimes not. You know, you guys have some very unique zones here. So this is what that looks like. Obviously much lower in scale. We found this. This is a bit of an anomaly. You have this sort of subzone of this character district 4 where you have kind of larger buildings on larger lots, but they're still kind of close to the street. You know, they're not quite neighborhood or suburban yet, you know, with a large yard or anything. And so this would be a subzone. So this would be on certain areas. And so we really tried to figure that out. And then there's one that just because we ran out of time, we got it drawn, we didn't get it colored. It's over on a great example is what's the name of the street? Sheaf. Yeah, thank you, Sheaf. So that street is so different. You know, it's like one of the few places in the entire city like that. And it looks like it used to be an alley and converted over time. But very, very interesting. And if it changed much, it would have a big impact on that little streetscape. And so, so one of the things we were thinking about is how to make a special zone for that, or even just a special requirement to help keep that intact. So all of the, you know, the pretty pictures and the, you know, kind of the planning stuff, all comes together, and this would be a page out of your zoning. And so here you start to see this is that fourth character district. So here's the artist rendering that JJ did. And, you know, people can easily understand what that looks like. And here, to take it one step further, showing you examples from around the area. And then on the other side is, kind of a prototypical block here. And start to look at each of the different setbacks and heights and all of the things that are particularly relevant to what gets built on a private lot. And so, you know, the code will have each one of the different zones having one of these pages. So you'll go through and it helps to really start to understand how it all works out. Then this was the trickiest part. We did what's called a regulating plan, and the regulating plan begins to spell out where these character zones are. So instead of your current zoning map, this would be your new zones. The thing that's great about it is look how rational that is. You can tell, right, that darker is kind of the more intense, the higher character, more urbane in character areas. And so here, that's what that begins to look like. And then on top of that, because we know that you guys have, again, this is that Sheaf Street. The thing that's unique about that is not the setbacks, not the heights, not the building types. The thing that's unique about it is, you know, kind of the street itself, which we don't have control over, it is there. But if you went in that street and you, for instance, exchanged a stoop for a storefront, It would have a big change in the character. So here we're looking at the concept of you know, requiring a stoop frontage or something, you know, that's not a commercial storefront, even though you guys have great storefronts here. But like there's that bookstore in the little duplex with the stoop there on that street, you know. So it would carry on that pattern. So that's a concept that we're looking at for how to deal with some of these really unique areas. And then the blue is showing where they would carry on the concept of the required shop front. So you're not having, you know, kind of residential expressions in these areas. So, you know, all of this, you know, we spent a lot of time studying the area in the past few days, but all of these things will, you know, be refined as we go through the process. So, and when we show the maps, this is when people tend to, what? You made it, you know, this area in that color? And, you know, kind of, so this is where, you know, some good feedback comes through. When the draft comes out, people will start to be able to give some good input on that. And then, of course, since we're here, and since you guys have the hot topic going on, we've realized that while a lot of these areas are similar in many, many of their characteristics, one of the distinguishing features is often height. And so we did this height overlay so that each of these different colors is keyed to and represents a different height within each of these character districts. So you basically say that, you know, in this area here, this is the most urban character, and we're showing, as we go down the street here, 1 to 3 stories. And again, we're talking stories, not feet, because that idea seemed to have a lot of traction with the community. People kind of understood that and got that concept. So we're looking at that, and then as we move in, there's some areas here where we've got 4 stories, and then we've got 3 stories with a short 4th. And so, you know, one of the things we've recognized, and you know, I've called in the experts here and asked, you know, I was like, what's going on in these short stories? And Richard told me, you know, well, there's like about a 6-foot high ceiling in there. And I said, wow, it's not likely to see many of those built anymore, you know, not that you can't have the same look, but it's, you know, it's kind of a quirky thing. And so how we deal with that, we're not sure as we go on, but, you know, we've documented it as it is. But the thing that's great about it is, you know, we're able to start to find some of these other areas where you've got, you know, kind of 2 and 3 stories. And the areas that we don't have the height overlays on, they're much more consistent in their stories. And they're the 4th character zone, not the 5th. And so I can't remember how what do we do for the 4th zone, Kara?
3 stories max.
What?
3 stories max.
So 3 stories max is what we're looking at there in the character zone, and that seemed to accommodate the commercial and mixed-use buildings, even the live-works, as well as the residential buildings, because you guys have some 3-story houses here, which a lot of places don't have. So that's pretty neat. So we really tried to, you know, study this and become as expert as we can, so we'll, again, this will be massaged and refined as we go through the process into the future. So what we wanted to do is go through and kind of how is all this applicable to what's going on here? You know, this is all, it's all, you know, we're talking about things, we're showing maps and lines and colors and all of that. Let's zero in, okay? So there's kind of 2 things that this zoning needs to do. One is, you know, kind of set the rules for what's there, kind of in the areas where it's not likely that something's going to happen, but you need to go ahead and set the rules. And then the other is what to do on the underutilized land that has development pressure, like these parking lots or other areas I was talking about. So we took a block and started to break it down and say, how does form-based zoning apply to this? So you guys all know this block. This is right down the street from where we've been hanging out all week. So looking at number of stories. So how do you determine what is a story? And so what we're looking at is kind of each level below the cornice. And so as we go through that, you know, here's 1-story, 2-story, 3-story, 1-story, 2-story. Now this is a little bit weird when you have a gable end facing the street, you know. So, you know, here technically if you kind of come around, yes, you can have the, you know, a slanted or diagonal cornice like that. But also as you come around the side of the building, you know, it's essentially the same feature as that. And so that's where you'd measure to. And one of the things that we're finding is that, you know, the buildings that you guys seem to have the most trouble with loving, the new ones, they tend to most often be flat roofed. One reason why buildings tend to be flat roofed is when you have a number of feet that is set, how do you get there and maximize that, and you do flat roof. So looking at this system allows you to begin to, it encourages pitched roofs, which are much more typical here in the city than anywhere else. So we wanted to do that. So we're defining it, okay? Definition is, because everyone says, well, how do you define a story? This is our working definition, okay? You wouldn't think it'd be so hard to define a story, but here we need to make sure we get it right. So a story is a habitable level of a building below the lowest point of its cornice or eave, habitable space within an attic. A pitched roof or raised basement is not a story. So that's one of the things that is, kind of have to figure out. Do we count the basement? You guys don't have very many basements that I've seen so far with little windows. So we need to figure out how to deal with that. But anyway, so that's our working definition. Setbacks. So here in this zone, in this area, in this particular zone, the setbacks are pretty much zero. There's a little bit of a small setback there. But the thing that's great about this fourth zone is there's much more kind of in and out in the variety than in when you get into the fifth zone. It tends to be much more sort of zero setback situation. But you guys still keep it tight, even in your fourth zone, in your fourth character zone. It tends to be zero, and there doesn't often have many little areas for greenery, except for on a few streets like State. As you walk down there, you have those cool row houses that are set back with the big granite steps that used to have a restaurant in one of them, I think. You got that going on. Here, the frontage type. So this is a shop front frontage type. This is a stoop frontage type. You remember we talked about the frontage types, and so each of the different frontage types that are allowed will be keyed for each of the zones. Building types. So here you could call this a live-work. This could be an apartment house, but since it's got the two doors there, it could also be considered a duplex. It's been converted, though, obviously, to commercial or mixed use. And it was great, actually, while I was outside today, taking pictures, looking nosy. The guys came out. Is this John, the barber? John came, what are you taking pictures of? What's going on? And so I told him, oh, I'm taking pictures of the beautiful architecture here. We're trying to make sure you're all safe and protected. And then they, he offered to give me a haircut. And then this guy came out, and apparently they're frenemies, So he's like, get out of here, you bum. And they were kind of, it was awesome. It was just like a movie. So not to me, to John. He was calling John a bum. So glazing percentages. So what percentage of the facade has to be in window? And so here's how you start to look at the glazing. So that's what you got. So let's look at an opportunity. Like if somebody were to take something and we just kind of turned around, right to the next block up. And here you have the parking lot for the bank. And as you go down, there's this big gap in the streetscape. It's fortunate right now there's actually a beautiful tree right there. And that would likely, it'd be awesome if, whatever happened could maintain those trees and just let them get bigger, because we know trees and street trees are few and far between in your downtown area. The image I'm about to show you doesn't have it there because it would block the whole view. So don't be concerned about that. But this was, the idea to take this and carry on your pattern, still keeping the parking lot in the rear that's there now, but doing this concept of the liner building that I've talked about, where it's a thinner building that covers the parking, so parking's always hidden in an urban area. And this is a little plan of it here. So here's the parking lot, here's the street, and here's one building. And what we wanted to do is illustrate the concept of how you transition from one of these character districts to the next. And so the map currently zones this in the fifth zone, but just at the other side of the street here, we move into the fourth zone. So this lot has the opportunity to mediate between those two zones. Well, in conventional zoning, especially in a use-based zoning, people would say, well, you need a buffer of some sort. You need a fence to protect you from the, or a hedge. But here, we actually just do this. So remember this building and this, keep your eye on the building. So here's the steeple, so you have a steeple view. So here you start to, create a civic space. The buildings are set back a little bit. You have a transition point from the fourth zone into the fifth zone and kind of steps up and works with it. But you start to see shop fronts coming in and outdoor dining and those kind of things. So you can imagine as you're walking down the street, how nice it would be instead of just having a parking lot. And then here we'd have this cool tree that was there. It would be amazing, in my opinion, it would be amazing. So here's how this breaks down. So frontage type again. So we've got the shop fronts. We've got the setbacks. We've got the number of stories measured accordingly. We've got the building types. We got the glazing percentages. And so that's how it all kind of works together. So I don't know if, you know, we've all been talking all this jargon and lingo and all these things and these zones and all that until this point. But you see, you know, it takes time, obviously. We did all this while we were here, you know. And so it takes time to get to that point where we can actually show you something so you can have something to respond to. So so that's the end. That's the end of my presentation, that is. So now, what I want to do is chat, as we always do. I'm sure there are still questions, even though we've got images now. And we've got the mic to pass around. I'm going to grab a chair here.
And if anybody has a question, you could either come up to the podium here to this mic, or you could raise your hand and I'll bring a mic over to you.
So, who's first?
Where'd the parking lot go?
Where did it go? The short answer is we're not here to talk about parking. No. The long answer is generally what we find is in a lot of cases the parking lots are underutilized. I know that one, though, it tends to be one where people go a lot and they say, well, you can find a spot there even when you can't find one elsewhere. That tells me that all the spaces aren't filled. So that's good. And so what we want to do is, you know, make sure that, you know, this building, to be a liner building, only needs to be about 20 feet deep. You know, you can have a coffee shop, an ice cream store, you know, whatever goes in. And so in some cases where you're doing, when you're constrained on a smaller lot like this, you definitely, you know, have to narrow it up. In other cases, you've got plenty of room and you can do a full depth building. So the, but again, you know, the idea is that the zoning says the parking goes in the rear, the parking's hidden from view, and, you know, it's left to the creativity of the landowner, the designer, to figure it all out. Obviously, if you covered the entire lot with these buildings and they go all the, you know, full depth, then you've lost parking there. And there's parking on the street too. Yes.
On this image up here now, this image up there now, we have the building in the middle, if you will, the two-story building with the, I don't know, third-story facade there on the top of it. No, the one next to the one, yes. It's got a little triangular bump on the top.
Yeah.
And the building to the right of that with the dormers on it, there's a substantial difference in height between those two buildings, and yet they're both called two-story buildings.
That's right.
How does, in regulation-wise, could, under form-based zoning, could the two on the left claim the same privileges to go up in height as high as the one on the right?
These two? Oh, this is your left? Which one?
No.
These two.
The purple one on the right is the tallest.
Yes.
Now, could the two on the left of that, legitimately claim that they don't have the space that the one on the right has because it's even though it's called two stories, the one on the right is substantially higher and has more floor space than the two on the left. So is that an argument that whoever owned the two on the left could increase the height so that, again, everybody goes to the highest level to maximize their floor space?
Well, I guess one thing is, you know, these guys are using this for habitable space here in the attic area. And these guys are not. And you see that, you know, throughout the city, where they're both conditions. I guess the question is, you know, I mean, if you look at this line, you kind of where it really hits here, you know, does it have a big impact that this is this much taller than this one? You know, and that's a, you know, kind of a personal preference.
If you were a developer trying to maximize your floor space,
right,
get more money in return for your development, I mean, wouldn't you want to push for the one on the tallest one of those three so you'd have more floor space?
Well, one of the differences that I didn't show is in the different zone, remember these are in two different zones and two different character district zones. And so you've got lot dimension size requirements that are different in the fourth zone than in the fifth zone. In the fifth zone, they're larger, which means the building itself would be larger like these other buildings are. Because what I found is when I walked around, your typical streets that have buildings that are about like this are, each of these buildings is about 24 feet or so wide, sometimes a little larger, sometimes a little smaller. And so that rhythm, remember the rhythm that we couldn't figure out how to spell? That rhythm of the 24 feet would be in the zoning, and so that starts to set that up. So because of the spatial constraints of some of the, you know, the building and the footprint configurations, it, you know, you basically, you're not, yes, this person could have made this taller if they wanted to, but because the building is broken down in its scale, they are able to be more compatible. Also, there can be gaps between these buildings. And here, you generally have a zero setback. They share a party wall. So there are a lot of things that go into it. You know, I know here, in this time especially, we're going to zero in on the height. I was expecting that. But what you'll find is when you go and you study the what's there, you'll see tall buildings, even in these fourth zones of your existing condition, that have, you know, kind of done this, but they're broken down, they're smaller, they feel great, everybody likes it. For instance, just down the street from where we proposed these are those row houses right across the street from Connie Bean. There's three in a row, and they go, what, three and then the short story on top. And so they would actually be taller than these, but they're acceptable and everyone loves them and still in the same character. So yes, there's, you know, the it's encouraging people to build in the roof, but the other option is, you know, building flat roof to get that that story in as well. So it's kind of a toss-up. We have to figure out how to solve it. But I think we've got it calibrated accurately and correctly for the character. And then the last thing is, you know, making sure that we've got those lot sizes correct and all of those kind of things.
So, could you have both? Could you have two stories but no higher than X number of feet?
You currently have, how does it work?
There's feet right now.
Yeah, so there's
a provision that actually says what he just said.
Yeah. Right, so you have, you know, this or whichever one's the lower and all of that. What we find is when you, again, there, I can sit here boldly and say to you, we know what's going on in this place from a you know, kind of a detailed metric perspective. And what we find is that if we start trying to get too specific, you're just going to get kind of a consistent line. You're going to get not the organic kind of messiness that's so beautiful about this place, and so I just urge you guys to be really careful about being so focused on the height issue. I mean, because here we're really talking about this or this, you know, and so we're encouraging pitched roofs that people might build in instead of flat roofs, and you know, so the net effect of it is giving you more of what you want. And again, we've got to, you know, we have to respect the rights of the property owners and all of that stuff too. You know, we don't want to just, you know, beat them up, so long as it's in keeping. So, yes, ma'am.
Is it possible to regulate?
Oh, sorry. Got the mic.
Thank you. Is it possible to regulate the type of building? Like this gentleman was just saying, you know, in terms of everybody building up to that height, if you have a hip roof, it's not going to be the height with the two dormers. So could you say if you have a place that has dormers, then on that street, you have to have maybe a different type of roof line or whatever just to keep that sort of organic thing? In other words, don't tell them what kind, but as long as it's not mirroring, you know, every building looking the same, as you were just saying.
Right. Yeah, I mean, one of the things that the zoning will have in it is acceptable and approved roof types. So we'll get into that. We'll talk about hipped roofs and gables and those kind of things. You know, as
would
far
that be like HDC that would say, okay, we already have a one of these types of structures, so now because we're in charge of sort of streetscape, let's do something else. Is that possible to zone it that way, or is that just sort of a
I mean, and that's thing? This is where I think probably the trickiest part of figuring out, because you do have this great HDC group and figuring out, you know, which things go in which, and again, you know, kind of what level of regulation do we want to put in this. We'll have to think about it. That's a good question.
I think it looks gorgeous, by the way.
Thank you. Thanks. We need two mics, don't we? It's hard. Oh, we do?
I'm wondering,
is it the podium?
the implementation of this particular presentation as far as now, we're looking at Daniel Street, right? As far as, okay. And if this were to come to fruition, there would be a number, probably, of developers that would approach each one of these. How do you get from the point of saying, gee, it would be nice if it looked this way, and then getting a sense of the community agreement on this should look this way? And how do you go from there to someone coming up and say, I want to build this particular one?
Yeah. So keep in mind, and that's a great question, thank you, and I always forget to clarify this. The things that we've drawn here, this is just as if somebody hired us to design what would happen on those on that parcel. It's not, this has to happen on that parcel just like this. So everybody, they would, whoever owned that property and wanted to do something with it, would design it. They'd go through, they'd read the zoning, they'd know what the height and the massing and all of those kind of things and the rhythm and the articulation and the glazing percentage and all that stuff needed to be. And then they would come, and it sounds like where we're heading is they would go through the HDC to look at all the details and make sure they got all of the architectural elements correct. I think what we're hearing from this process is that if somebody's going to do something that's, if somebody redeveloped this parking lot all together at one time, that'd be a big deal on the street. And so it's likely that, knowing you all now, that they would come and say, hey, here's what we're thinking about. What do you think? They don't, I don't know if they'll have to do that. Most cities don't make people do that. That's why they have the normal approval process. It seems like it might be a good idea for that to happen. And then, I guess as people go through the normal process with the that's existing right now, then they'll, the citizens have their opportunities to give their input, et cetera. But, those kind of things are up for discussion as well. Generally, though, I think the idea is to kind of stick with the system, just determine which thing goes in which bucket, which is zoning, form-based zoning, which is HDC details. So we're still sorting through it, is the answer. Hold on 1 second. Yes, and then can you get the mic up here for him and let him go while he's at the podium? All right. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Wes.
Hey, Wes.
And I'm trying to get my head around what it is that I'm being presented to consider.
Good.
First off, I appreciate the extensive amount of inventory and looking and considering that you've done. Obviously, we can't go through every page of what you've done tonight, but from what you've showed us, it's really extensive. And I think what you're pointing to is some ideas as to what makes sense after considering all that data as a foundation for a conversation to continue. Am I in the neighborhood?
Yeah. So, yes. So the idea is, as you're giving us feedback, you're giving us new ideas and things to consider. We're documenting it all still, that you will have an opportunity to go through all the pages, every page. That's the part, Right now, all the pages aren't even written. So when they're written and disseminated, you guys literally can go through and give, very, very detailed feedback. And so when I ask you what questions and comments you have right now, don't feel like you've got to, if I don't ask right now this one specific super detailed thing, I've lost my chance. And the odds are, too, we may not know the answer even at this point, just being honest.
So, do you have an idea when that'll be? When it'll get published?
August.
Okay, thanks.
Stay tuned. Yes, sir.
Hello, I'm David Nord, and I'd just like to clarify something. The building on the corner on the left there, if this new zoning is implemented, are you saying that in that location, the two stories would be the most appropriate for that location?
Yeah, so in this zone, they would be, like in the fourth zone, it's up to three. You know, so they can go up to three, which is in character, in keeping with what's existing currently. And so that would be, they could do something like that, you know, with
okay, the building on the corner, that land is owned, I believe, either by the Bank of America or another bank.
That's right.
And I'm wondering, I don't have any doubts that a banking institution is not going to pledge their loyalty to Portsmouth. They're going to pledge their loyalty to the balance sheet in American dollars. Yeah. I mean, how much power would the HDC or whatever commissions are further established, what kind of power would they have to really play hardball in the, in determining the heights of that piece of property on the corner?
Yeah, well, the zoning, just like right now, it has zoning on that property that says how high it can be. And if the bank or, you know, sold it to somebody or they decided that it made sense for their bottom line to develop the property, then they would comply with the existing zoning. Well, once the form-based zoning goes into, you know, is enacted and adopted, then they would, those would be their rules. They would have to comply with that if they develop the property.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. And one thing to say, too, is the... it doesn't mean that once the zoning is in place that they have to go develop it right away. It's, you know, it's until they decide to do something with their property that they do. So, there's one over there, Rick.
Ryan, more abstractly speaking, what the gentleman referred to is that this arrangement may have ramifications as to the economic value as well as the tax base, as well as for what ever reason some people may hold on to their property believing that 10 years hence.
Could you speak up a little bit better?
Yeah, I want to address just more abstractly some of the financial ramifications of the zoning and whether you can give us any feedback as to what your experience has been. Clearly, to be limited to a two-story building when in fact a developer would have loved to build four has some effect on the market value of the property as well as in the future on the tax base?
Yeah, that's a great question. So for clarification's sake, they could go three, even though they might like to do four. They don't have to do two. What we found is that in Portsmouth, building heights do this all the time. You know, you guys change stuff around, you know, pretty frequently here, especially recently. And so in most places, if somebody asks me that question, I'd say, oh, don't worry, because we're completely, you know, we're giving you this new form-based approach, and now people can build the street and make walkable, you know, lovable places. The value will go way up, and people will want to do these things. It'll be great, because before all they could do was something suburban. I can't say that here, because you already have the fabric. The zoning allows you to do good stuff already, but as you can see, it also allows you to do stuff that, you know, may not be, you know, what everyone's looking for so far. So, you know, that's for you guys to sort out. You know, the financial ramifications to the landowner, you know, are kind of outside this, our scope. You know, what we do is, you know, give you the tools.
Right. So you. I just want to make sure that we understand that there are ramifications.
Yes. Yes, oh, we do. Yes, thank you. Yes, we have
I wondered if you had some thoughts about the Worth parking lot area that so many people put red dots on, and also the Parrot Avenue parking. Those were two areas of concern.
Yes, thank you. So we, let's see. So the short answer is we're not here to talk about parking, and especially not here to talk about Parrot Ave or the Peacock. So we showed a few ideas the other night with mixed reviews, and I think that I've discovered that I'm best served to stick to zoning in Portsmouth. You know, when it comes to parking, what we're here to cover is when you do it, when a private developer does it, more specifically, where does it go? And it goes in the back, and it goes where it's not obtrusive to the streetscape, and you can't see it. And so that's really, that's kind of our thing. So, There's a lot of opinions about those topics. He's coming to you with the mic.
I was wondering what the time frame of this process is, actually, if you know it is approved. I heard 5 to 10 years in one meeting, and that scared me because, of course, the developers could quickly pass, you know, grandfather things through and so on. And secondly, I'm the spelling police,
the rhythm woman,
and you misspelled stories. And it's S-T-O-R-E-Y-S, and for your credibility, you know, you had it like 5 times misspelled there, so you might just...
It's copy and paste.
Fix that.
We only misspelled
it. You can hire me as an editor.
We had...
But I love what you've done. I mean...
Yes, that's the American spelling of it.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. But thank you for all your thorough work, and I think your vision the other night was wonderful for the piazza and cobblestone piazza, so... I know that's not the topic tonight, but thanks for everything, really.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. I appreciate it. Let's see. So now, yes, thank you. You threw me off with the misspellings. I'm very sensitive to that because I'm a terrible speller and I need a new software. But so the timeline. So 5 to 10 years. Boy, I hope not. But it depends on you guys. Honestly, you know. There are places where it could take 5 to 10 years, you know, if we want to. There are a couple of different approaches to moving forward a zoning change. One is that it must be 1,000,000% perfect before you can do anything, before you can make a move. The other is, it's, you know, we've addressed these issues and these certain specific concerns that we've all been fighting over, and let's move forward. And because it is zoning, if we something pops up, we just make a change. You know, you just fix it as you go. So it depends on you. I mean, we just had a form-based zoning ordinance and approved in Maine in a few months, which is super fast. I mean, they did it really fast. You know, there are places that, you know, literally work on zoning changes for years. I don't recommend that because only the strong will survive that. There will only be 3 people left in the meeting room. What we like to do is move things as quickly as we can because of all the energy and enthusiasm and things that happen during this process. And we also, people don't forget why they were saying what they were saying. You know, it's like, now why did they pick that height again? I can't remember. I know it had something to do with they walked around. And so,
Brian, can I just say...
I'll let Rick give the real answer.
Yeah, let me just say, we're very eager to get this move forward. And so, as I said earlier, we're going to have the discussion draft available in August. And we're going to have a very intensive review period for that. This whole process is not meant to have lots of delays and lots of meetings. We really want to get this moving. So we want to get a next draft after the discussion draft to the City Council and the Planning Board in September. And our intent is to try to set up a series of meetings with the work sessions with the Planning Board beginning in August, going into October, initial meeting presentation to the City Council in September, with the intent of trying to get this enacted by the City Council before the City Council's term ends in December. If that can't happen, then we have to start over again in January. I think with the intensive charrette process that we've had this week and all of the work that you've all put into it and all the input you've already had, we have enough information to try to put this together and get a workable product out and into the actual adoption process starting in September.
Could you type something up tonight and we'll sign it?
I just have a quick question. I noticed that in this scenario, you preserve the view of the church steeple. Is that so with most of it, would you say, or all of it throughout the district that you studied?
Yeah, one of the things that we did when we were doing those view shed studies, and we figured out it's really hard to calculate, you know, and figure out how to directly preserve them and where they are from, because there are a lot of them. And like, so for instance, is the view over the parking garage a precious view? You know, has a parking garage, you know, diminished the view enough that it's not that important? It'd be hard to block that view unless you did something really tall, because that's kind of looms large. Is the view over the courtyard with the blue lights where all the college kids hang out at night? Is that, you know, there's a view there. But what we found is, and what you notice, this view, you know, even if you built taller here, is still intact. And so there are a lot of views. It just depends on where you are. That's the trickiest part about it. If you protect every view from everywhere, from every moment, it's like it's just stuck as it is today. Nothing can ever change. And what I found was when you're standing right in front of the church, if there's a, you know, I'm 6 foot two and a half. If there's a 6 foot four guy in front of me, that view is blocked and I'm 5 feet away, you know? And so kind of figuring out it's hard. But when we're looking at, you know, vista terminations and some of those things where it's easy to say, well, I can see it down this street. I can see the view of the naval yard from down this street. You know, all of these kind of things, you know, you can more easily sort of quantify how to do that and start to look at, you know, can we incorporate something in the ordinance to cover that? But it's tricky, for sure. Who's next?
I have the mic. Mary Lou McElwain. I noticed in many of the photographs that you put up on the board that there are utility lines overhead. And I'm wondering if it's in your scope to have underground utilities. Is that part of your design process? Because it sure looks nice right here.
Yeah, well, JJ took some artistic license here. And, you know, I am glad to see that on some of your streets you have them only on one side. And so at least one side looks good. Whenever I'm in New England, I always complain about this. I'm like, what's with the power lines, guys? I understand this is old in these streets, but you tear up the streets and, yeah, but there's the this and the water table and the ledge and the whatever. And, you know, in a lot of the places we work, it's just there. In my town in Franklin that I showed you guys the first night, and they started on the main street, on like the most precious street, and just like street by street, as they can afford it, they're kind of putting them underground. But what I found is every time I complain about it, people in New England are like, what? What do you mean? It's just some power lines. And it's like they're so used to it. And so I just quit bringing it up recently. I was just like, you know, we've shown it without it. It would be great, you know, if you could do it. I feel like it has an economic impact on, you know, kind of the lovability of the city. It makes more people want to come, but you guys don't have any problem attracting people, I've noticed. So, you know, you got to pick your battles, but underground power lines are great when you can do them. But that's just my outsider's opinion. Yes, sir.
Hi, Steve McHenry from McHenry Architecture. A couple comments. One, first of all, great work on getting the engagement of the community going. I would encourage a way of finding more inclusion of these principles in the northern tier and the areas west of Maplewood Avenue and down Islington Street, primarily because there are more opportunities for development there and more room for error. But also more potential for intermodal transportation, which is the answer to not putting parking garages in the central business district. So any way we can encourage the expansion of this idea into a larger area is something I would encourage. And the other is see if I can get you to proffer an opinion because of your broad experience around the country and other cities. whether or not you have an opinion on modern architecture fitting into the context of old buildings. What you show are delightful sketches of buildings in the vernacular that exist already. Is that the only way to design buildings? We struggle with this all the time. There are many cities around the world where old and new can mix together. Do you have an opinion on that?
Yeah, thanks. Appreciate that question. I'll save that one to last. And by the way, we're over at 8:30. That's a tricky one. I mean, for me, I tend to, it's a local question. You know, some places they're like absolutely modern. You know, we can't do as good as we used to with the old stuff. So we've got to do what we can do and do it well. We'll look at the rhythm and the proportions and all of those things and make sure we respect the streetscape, et cetera, et cetera. At least with the people that I've met so far here, the majority of them would, if I said do modern too, they would run me out right this moment and they would carry me out actually. Yeah, so I would say that you're lucky here that, you know, it looks like for the most part, the new stuff that's going in is, and you've all heard me say this, is better than they get in most cities in the country. And that's because, you know, you guys kick people's butt and make them do it, which is great. and they have a lot to work with. They look at the stuff you have, you know, it's like, oh, of course, we'll just, you know, do it like that as best we can. So I'm going to leave that to you guys to sort out. Yes, Richard.
Brian, on the zoning side, to make this work, can you give a couple of examples with these last couple of slides of, so what's in the code that says this? What's the kind of language that's actually going to pull these kinds of ideas on paper that we get to review in August and September and October?
Sure. So this one, for instance, it will say that, how does the language read exactly?
Bill?
On the glazing, it'd be as simple as a two-liner that say that buildings within the CD4 will have the percentage of glazing set forth on the table, and then the table that Brian showed you has it right on it. It'll say whatever percent right there on it.
So very simple, and the setbacks, of course, the same. The frontage types will be, you know, these are the permitted frontage types per zone. It's all listed there. Oh, yeah. Thanks. Good idea. Well, easier said than done. It's a lot of stuff in here. There we go. Okay. So,
the text would say, go see this table.
It would say, go see the table for facade glazing percentage, and it's right, literally right here. So it's and most of the elements are handled that way. Sometimes you have to have more text than that, but most of the elements are that simple.
We try to keep it really simple so that it's just, you know, it's thinner, so you don't mind using it and looking at it and all of those kind of things. Hey.
Back to modern buildings, I think that's very subjective. I think you could get a lot of different answers from people in this room tonight and from people in this community. Personally, I feel that some of the things that are done in what wasn't considered inside the moat, as Nick described it the other night so well, the things that are in what we call Hotel City, or I call it Hotel City, could have been done in a more interesting way. However, we've always got the problem of the developers trying to do it in the way that's easiest for them and probably for the less cost for the, you know, to get the most out of it. But I do think, having been in New York often, that there can be modern buildings which could be terrific, but they have to be done well.
Now everybody starts to speak up about that issue.
One aspect of this particular part of the city, not the part in where the hotels are, but in this particular part of the city, is remember you've got the historic district overlay on it. And so that tends to lead you to a more traditional historic pattern. So.
But I was talking about, in particular, the Hotel City area, which can be quite boring.
Back to your last drawing of Daniel Street where you had the transition zone.
Yeah.
How did you get a setback in the first corner, since that didn't seem to be a part of either of zones on the, you know, on the riverside or further toward Market Square?
There are, in that particular location. What we did was we actually created a civic space on the corner. Actually, a small plaza, because there's a lack of civic space in that area. So much like the little pocket park you guys have on Court Street, State Street. By the way, the coolest little pocket park I've ever seen, I think. So the idea is this is kind of an urban expression of that. And that setback is a little bit, you know, exaggerated, so you can start to see, you know, the point, you know, that was one of the benefits of that. So that's right. So the setback would be measured actually from the back of the plaza there. So wow, you guys are very observant. This is awesome. This is very technical zoning discussion, more so than normal.
Hi, I'm Carol Chelman, and thank you very much. I missed the beginning of the presentation, so if you already covered this, I apologize. Oh. Okay. Is that better?
Yeah. Perfect.
Hi. So my question is green roofs. Does that have any relevance to form-based zoning? What do you think about green roofs? Are they, I mean, it seemed like it was in for a while. Is it still in nationally? Do they work? Would they make sense in Portsmouth? I hear a lot of talk from people that they want more green space.
Yeah.
And when you said about putting the cars in the back, I kind of thought that was interesting because you're still taking up space from where the building was. So I don't know if the cars are getting smaller or what's happening there.
Yeah.
But what about putting the cars underground?
Yes. Well, and that's, why didn't I think of that when you asked me where do the cars go? Apparently, it's no big deal here to put cars underground. It's like even on a small development, people are doing it. It's because the market can bear it here. And a lot of communities forget about, you know, don't even think about digging 1 inch to put parking down, you know. So, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
So green roofs.
Yeah, so green roofs. Okay, so green roofs are still in around the country. People love them. And in fact, I think they're growing in popularity now that the people are learning how to do them so they don't leak and stuff. And and they're also moving beyond just having green roofs for utilitarian purposes of, you know, where it's just simply greenery planted up there, and now people are making them habitable, beautiful gardens and those kinds of things. Obviously, on a flat roof building, it's much easier to do that. To figure out a way to incorporate it into a building that has a pitched roof is tricky because you end up doing kind of a pitched parapet, and it's like not really a pitched roof. And so there's some things like that, but you know, with good design, I mean, it's possible to move that forward. The thing about a green roof, though, that's interesting is when you're thinking about the form-based zoning, somebody talked about parking. So you end up having the roof is on the top. You know, people don't see it. The form of it is not having to do with the character of the zone. So it tends to not often find its way into zoning. One thing you can do is make sure that they are not prohibited. Another thing that I just learned today, one of the architects in town came in and was telling me that appurtenances on the roof can't be habitable. And so, for instance, if you wanted to do a green roof where somebody could go up there and actually have an elevator that where you have to come out and, you know, have cover or a restroom that, you know, up there, you can't do that, but you can have a mechanical room with a door that, because I thought, you know, maybe it was just something low, you know, and said, oh no, people can walk in the mechanical room. And if it's not visible from the thoroughfare, from the street, from the sidewalk, you know, then that's something you might be able to consider. So starting making it easier for somebody to do something habitable on the roof. But as far as, you know, can you do a green roof or not, you know, if we want to, do you allow them now in the zoning? Yeah, so you wouldn't change that if you already do. And so you can maybe, you know, change how you define a rooftop appurtenance to allow for some things that might encourage that or make it easier for people to do it. So that's just literally something I heard today. So.
And if I could just slide a parking question in.
Nope, the alarm will go off again.
It's actually not a parking question. It's an economics question. What do you think about the number of surface parking lots in this city in general?
Yeah.
And the fact that they're owned by banks, economically speaking, that doesn't really make sense. Why is that happening? Why aren't they selling them and developers buying them and putting up buildings on all the parking lots?
Well, I said the other night, I've said it several times now, that the surface parking lots like you have right now that have, you know, eroded your urban fabric are more than unfortunate. And the you know, that's kind of why we're, you know, that why we're doing this, so we can make sure that when those things happen, because, you know, it's likely that they will. You know, as banks are going less and less bricks and mortar and they're going more online and all that, but we understand that they're going strong here, but at some point in time, you know, things may shift. And when that happens, you guys will be ready, because those are the most, you know, developable and underutilized sites. You know, because one of the things that's important in a place like this is to, you know, as much as you can, and no less than you do now currently, you know, let me clarify, the form-based zoning approach shouldn't make it easier to demolish the buildings you currently have. you know, and so we want to kind of shift the, you know, focus to the underutilized properties rather than tearing stuff down. And so so I think that, you know, as market changes, you know, I mean, the banks are the market for, in a lot of cases. You know, they're the top of the food chain. They're the last ones that not have money in a lot of cases because they've got yours. And so, you know, they don't often have to think about developing their parking lots or not, but they do.
Thank you. So. Thanks so much. Thank you for your work.
Yes, you're welcome.
Dan Rowling, Portsmouth. And I think that you presented a lot of very interesting concepts, and I think we can use them to work with and guide some of the development in the town very well. I do want to comment, and it's not so much what you presented, but I want some community awareness around, if we were to take and develop a concept like what we see on Daniel Street, we have core architectural requirements now that consumes vast amounts of space in our buildings. So you have two stair towers, exit corridors, handicapped access through elevators that require, or that have to be large enough for hospital gurneys and everything. So that what you see is that we will never be building cute little buildings like the buildings that make up Portsmouth anymore. Yeah. What we have to deal with is larger block buildings and then work on regulating scale elements to make them work. So a project like yours could be built, but the reality of it would be that all those three buildings would actually be one building, one development, one set of elevators, two stair towers, you know, sets of handicapped bathrooms, all in one building, because at least one of your buildings is core requirements in what we're seeing here.
Yeah.
So that's something for the community to recognize and realize that the challenges are in breaking down the scales of these large buildings so that they are compatible with our town and represent the image that you're portraying, you know.
Yeah, that's a great point. Times have changed, you know, and so we've got to figure out how to work within those parameters and still get what you want, you know, things you're happy with.
Hi, Carla Goodnight from CJ Architects. I would like to follow up on that question or comment by asking your outside opinion. We do have a big problem to address, or as he pointed out, but how would you suggest we address that other than feet and inches of building height and mass and size? Because you've mentioned on multiple occasions that we have quite a variety of heights and sizes and so forth in the city, and some of them are quite large, like Atrezzi, the Atrezzi building, but it still fits in very well with the fabric of the city. And we have some 6 and 7 story tall, little tiny footprints and up and down everywhere. But what are the elements we're not talking about in your opinion?
Yeah, I mean, I think from my perspective, the number of stories is the key, because it allows that variety and, you know, natural variation, and it allows people to use good sense, you know. I mean, there's always, you know, and you see it in all historic towns, there's always that one odd fellow who makes their stories extra tall. Get it? The odd fellow? There's this three-story building. It's really tall. Oh, man. So, but anyways, there's always somebody who could do something unusual under that regime. Mm-hmm. However, in general, unless people have unlimited resources, which no developer in the universe has right now, they use good common sense, and they kind of figure out what works for them. And what you'll find is that you'll get this, instead of just this, which we found that. We thought at first people want only that, you know, and we've learned since then that that's not the case. So, stories, not feet. Certainly not inches. Went way over on the other side.
Making me work.
Yeah.
I have a question. The image that is on the right side of the screen that you have right now, do I understand that that is literally what the zoning ordinance is going to look like, is a picture with data underneath it, or am I mistaken?
That's correct. Yes. Yes, in fact, it is. So this is a non-regulatory image, right? That's how we set it up. So photographs, renderings, and things like that are not regulatory. So, you know, if we have a dog in here, you don't say, well, you have to have dogs in front of all buildings in Character District 4. And so each of these numbers, this is basically to help you understand what the heck A is. Where is A? A means this. And so it's really like just a user-friendly way to present the numbers. Because in most zoning ordinances, it's just like this table, this spreadsheet that, you know, I can't look at.
All right, so the zoning ordinance is basically going to be page after page of images such as you have up there.
No, it has lots of boring pages too. Well,
that's unfortunate.
Yeah, well, they have to. It's a legal document, unfortunately. No offense, Dad. But so there are lots of the pages with words. But the key important pages are like this. And so, you know, you walk into the planning department and you say, what the heck can I do with my property in this character district 4? And they say, here. And you can hand them, you know, here's the Cliff's Notes version. Make sure you read all the rest in the, I don't know, how thick is your zoning right now? Pretty fat. So, you know, in this thinner document, but if you want to know generally what you can do, look here first, and people can say, oh, I get it. So,
all right, thank you. Yes.
We're still working on trying to make the legal part sexy, but it's hard.
I just wanted to ask you a quick question. Do you have provisions for, it's on two tiers, a live-work type of buildings? And two, who elicits the business from the developers? In other words, it seems to be like downtown, it's a lot of gift shops. Used to be a hardware store there. Are people actively going after businesses like a good butcher, a good dry cleaner, high-quality businesses that are not involved in gift stores or banks?
Yeah, well, yes to the first question about LiveWorks. So LiveWork is a specific building type that we define and allow in different zones. So yes, good question. The second answer to the second question is that the gift shops and stuff is because you're such a desirable place. That happens to all awesome places. And it gets, you know, less and less relevant to the citizens who live there. And it's just in the end is market driven. So I don't know if there's a more specific Portsmouth answer, but it's tricky.
A thought comes to mind, like at Beacon Hill, they actually have a butcher, the Lucas, a breakfast place, a shoe repair place. So I respectfully, you know, agree to disagree on that because I do think it's important to have the live workspace. I know in Tempe, Arizona, they're doing that. It works very successfully.
Sure.
And you could, people like that historical outside facade, and they would be in love with that. And I think it to make it more of a livable, less kind of going out to the highway to do shopping, you know?
Yeah. Just no, you're right. I mean, the more of that you guys can get, the better. And the, you know, having the live-work typology set up as one of our allowed building types will hopefully help encourage that more. But, you know, a lot of times it's just, you know, the market. But you're right, there are places that are exceptions to that rule,
but
for sure.
People proactively go after certain businesses.
I don't know what you have here.
Yeah,
Chamber of Commerce and the landowner generally is the answer. I'm not sure what you guys do here. Right. Yes, sir.
Do you have or when will you have on a map outlining these various districts that you're speaking of, you know, where you say this is where Zone 5 will be and this is where Zone 4 will be? And
yes.
When will you have that if you don't have it already?
It was in there. That was the one, that was the purple colors.
Okay.
That
so
was
those,
it.
Those
are the zones. And that's the rough draft. But we feel pretty good about it, but it's still, I'll just say that, it's a rough draft. So.
Okay. Good, thanks.
Yes. Yeah, we knew that would be, you know, important for us to start to understand. We had to know what the character areas were so we'd know how many zones and those kind of things, subzones.
Can you bring that slide back on the zones, subzones?
If we must. Which way did I go? Did I pass it already? Oh. That wasn't it. There we go. There. So this is the character districts, and then we have these different, and it's still underneath there. It's probably just hard to see. The character districts are still there, and then these are the special requirements that would be for each of the kind of more specific areas. This is a really fine grain regulation, which is the hardest part to do. Yes.
Yes, my name is Keith Evelyn from Portsmouth and Rye. People need real transparency, and they have to be able to read things very fast. They really can't get a good idea even from enhanced photographs and from architectural drawings. One of the things that would really help, and I've mentioned it to you, I came over to the Charette today, and I asked, when I handed in my critique, I asked if a virtual 3D image of the city was possible, and to have developers actually create a 3D visual thing to move in with this type of thing. And I was told at first that this wasn't what you were looking at right now. But then you came over to me, took me over to one of your bright young people, and he was typing away. And in fact, you have done a virtual 3D of the entire area that you're talking about, which was absolutely wonderful. And I think for people in the city to be able to go online quickly, because people are busy, they want a quick fix, just like somebody coming to a light changes and they beep beforehand. We need something that we can look at quickly and spend 2 minutes looking at the photographs, the architectural renderings, and a virtual thing that we can actually move around the way this fellow did today. From the top, from the side, we can see mass, we can see height and everything. Yeah. I think that would really help.
Sure. Yeah, so we built a 3D model of the downtown. Very simple, very simple. I mean, it's just simply boxes massing. It turns out that Market Square, somebody took it upon themselves to model it, and all the facades have been put on, like photo real estate facades, and we just plugged it right into our model. It's amazing. Probably somebody in this room made it, because you guys all care, but we actually built, we drew this, we took our little sketch, our design, put it into our 3D model, just like he's talking about, and JJ drew this using our 3D model, so it is, I know exactly how wide that building is, how high it is, exactly how, you know, all of this stuff, it's there, it's real. So the one thing I will say, though, is you can't spin it around right here, like he's talking about, but one thing I will say is you guys are lucky. So far the submittals and things that I've seen a lot of times have a higher degree of execution here than they do in many, many cities. I see 3D models, and I see the photo manipulations and stuff, and so they're on the right path already. So I told him that we, you know, the reason I said we weren't doing it, it wasn't part of our scope, because it's not. We just do it because that's what we needed to do the drawings. But if he wants, I'll leave it with Nick, and then Nick can play with it, and you guys figure out what to do. So,
Brian, one of the concerns I've heard through the numerous visits I've had with you and with others, is what is a story? And I know you keep talking about three stories in this particular, and I know you gave us an example of a story, but have you ever seen where there is a maximum of a story, like a first floor, a maximum of a second floor, a maximum of a third floor, maybe not a height of a building, but a maximum of a story? Because I think I'm hearing concerns with that, because you could technically have a very tall first story with huge windows and a smaller second story, even if you do height. But what have you ever seen, or have you ever done a maximum of a story?
Yeah.
And I think that's a concern I've heard over and over from people in our community since we've started talking about stories, which I think was Saturday or Friday. It's kind of all rolled together, but at that point.
Yep. That's a good question. We've intentionally not focused on that with you guys, because I want to get you on the concept of stories, and it sounds like we're there now, so now we'll give you the...
There is a way, and some of the provisions, some of the terrible text provisions that we don't have a good way to graphically illustrate, some of them they'll talk about what the minimum and maximum, particularly first floor height is. But when you're on the street walking around, that's what you're sensing, is that part. But there, you know, it would be easy enough if the city decided it wanted to do it to say that the stories above the first floor would be between, you know, whatever, 8 feet and 12 feet. It's certainly a possible thing to do. And that way it limits. The other thing is that there's a market pressure that keeps people from making stories really big because it's expensive to go this way. The problem that they really will do is they'll start doing this way, yeah, and you'll end up with little squatty cheap floors.
So we need to make sure we have a minimum.
Yeah, it's a lot more about a minimum as far as quality construction goes.
You'll be getting some of those 6 foot half foot stories up there. Right. Who has the mic? Oh, Rick, you have a question? What time is it?
10 o'clock.
Oh, wow. All right. So I'll do the old trick. Who wants to go last? Last one more question. And then everybody raises their hand. All right.
Brian, I wanted to thank you and your firm for spending the weekend with us. I hope you've learned a lot. It's so valuable for me to have a firm come from the outside who has national perspectives, and it's also encouraging to hear that our problems are not new. You've seen them other places, and there are tools to solve our problems. And so I'm very excited about that. I'm very excited about the progress we've made so far, and I'm hoping we can make this a reality, not 5 years in the future, but maybe 5 months in the future. Secondly, I want to thank the city staff. I mean, this wouldn't have happened. I know they're a great team, but it wouldn't have happened without the staff that we have, the finest planning staff in all the state of New Hampshire.
Yeah.
And good for them. So, and finally, of course, success of this product and the success of it a few months from now is only due to all of you who showed up tonight and who showed up this weekend and on Thursday night. And I hope all of you continue to engage the process as we make this a reality for the survey area that we started with. And if it's a success, as some people have said, Islington Street, the Northern Tier, we can continue to build on this success as we go forward. So, yeah. Thank you.
Good. Thanks. All right. So hopefully this won't be the last time you guys see me. We're going to go home and rest. I've been on the road for a while. And this has been, for me, one of the most exciting projects that we've worked on. We've worked in other historic places, but this place is different. And I always tell people, I know, you think your community is so unique and your citizens are so unique, whatever, but you guys truly are unique. Take it for what it's worth. But it's been great because you guys are so passionate about it, and it's no wonder when you walk outside and see what you have here. I was asking, can I get a print of the historic map? I collect these maps and I want to hang one on my wall. There's only been one or two other places where I've gotten the map and felt like I wanted to hang it up. So this place is amazing, and hopefully we can just make sure we do justice to you guys and protect the place that you love. So thanks for coming.